That's about all of it. For any of your news agencies that I haven't talked to, I think I've talked to almost everybody. At 1 o'clock today on 4th Street, I'll be doing an update on the two children that went off the roof in South Minneapolis yesterday. We'll do a case update. We'll talk about the status of the child and the status of the investigation. So we'll get you all up to speed on that.
At
1 o'clock, yes, ma'am.
4th Street and what?
4th Street right outside of City Hall.
Okay.
So I used to be on 5th Street, but the light rail lady kept talking over me.
Yeah.
It's like I was at home with my children.
And just only because there seems to be some confusion. Is it now the roof? Is that what they talk about?
I don't know. As soon as I get briefed from investigators, I'll be happy to share that.
Okay, I just was asking.
Yeah, that's your job. I love that.
Only because it seems to be.
There's a lot of debate. This whole thing's got a lot of debate.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. That's a horrible case for.
No,
I
have
yeah, no. I know you're not.
Yeah,
no, I know you're not smack talking it. I appreciate that completely. But, yeah, no, it's, this has been a particularly hard one on everybody. Oh, and we'll also do just a quick briefing for also attached to that on the homicide from last night in Minneapolis.
Good afternoon. My name is Jacob Fry. I'm the mayor of Minneapolis, and I am joined by my colleagues on the City Council, Councilmember Andrew Johnson, Councilmember Cam Gordon, Councilmember Philippe Cunningham, Councilmember Jeremy Schrader, Council President Lisa Bender, Councilmember Jeremiah Ellison, Council Vice President Andrea Jenkins, Council Member Lene Palmisano, our Chief of Police, Arredondo Madera, and our City Attorney, Susan Siegel. And thank you all for being here today. The last 2 days, I was in settlement discussions with Council President Lisa Bender, Council Vice President Andrea Jenkins, and Council Member Jeremiah Ellison. I want to be clear up front, we cannot comment on what occurred during the mediation, which took place the last couple of days, and we cannot comment on the settlement conference, which occurred earlier today, but we will provide you with the result of those discussions right now. We reached a settlement of $18 million to be provided to the Ruschik family and an additional $2 million that they will then donate to the Fund for Safe Communities at the Minneapolis Foundation. My colleagues will explain a bit more about that fund in a moment. And the City Council just voted unanimously to approve this settlement. I fully support their decision, and I will be approving it shortly. This is not a victory for anyone, but rather a way for our city to move forward. And I do believe that we will move forward together, united in the shared belief that such a tragedy should never occur in our city. I would like to thank Council President Lisa Bender, and I would now like to invite her up to the podium.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm Lisa Bender. I'm the president of the Minneapolis City Council. We began discussion of this $50 million civil complaint following an unprecedented criminal conviction of Mohammed Noor of third-degree murder. We know that no amount of money can heal the pain of the Ruschik family or any family that has lost a loved one in this way. It is our continued commitment to work together with our community to demand and support change to policing. It was a priority for the City Council and the mayor that part of this settlement include funds to be invested to address broader issues of police violence in our communities, which we all know disproportionately impact communities of color. And on this, I'd like to thank Councilmember Ellison for his leadership and invite him to speak more about this.
I would like to thank the mayor and the council president for their leadership as we face down this issue. My name is Jeremiah Ellison, and I represent Ward 5, representing North Minneapolis. This is not the first police-involved shooting in Minneapolis, and many of us on the council have spent our careers fighting for justice in instances similar to this one, and we haven't always been successful. I think it says a lot that the Ruschiks chose to stand in solidarity with other victims of police violence and agreed as a part of this settlement to contribute $2 million to the Fund for Safe Communities at the Minneapolis Foundation, which is committed to address all forms of gun violence centering youth and communities most impacted. It's our understanding that the Minneapolis Foundation will seek direct input from other families who have been impacted by police violence. And I would like to also thank the Council Vice President, Andrea Jenkins, for her leadership and invite her up to say a few words.
Thank you, Councilmember Ellison. My name is Andrea Jenkins. I represent the 8th Ward in Minneapolis. Today, we approved a settlement in an unprecedented case that involved a former MPD officer convicted of third-degree murder of a member of our community. This tragedy, as unfortunate as it was, happens far too often in our communities. Public safety and police trust must be our utmost concern moving forward. This deeply painful incident has already instituted changes in our police department, beginning with new leadership and naming a new police chief, body-worn camera policies, and a number of other policy changes that we believe will lead to more accountability and more community trust. And to talk about that a little bit further, I invite up Councilmember Lene Palmisano.
We are here today because Justine is not. We're here because her life was taken too soon, and because her death has impacted so many of us in ways that we don't always have the words to describe. 21 months ago, I was one of the most vocal critics of our police department. I called for a change in leadership and demanded accountability from top to bottom at City Hall. We still have progress to make. Today, I am joined by colleagues who share deeply in this commitment, and Mayor Fry, with whom I work closely to implement our new chief's important vision. The work we must do is not simple or easy, but it can be achieved through collaboration. To Justine's family and every resident of the city of Minneapolis, there is no way for us to say sorry enough. Nothing we do will bring Justine back, but this is the best way for us to move on. It is my hope that her family, loved ones, and the community may now take a step toward healing. This settlement allows us to continue that work around improving our police department. We as a city are committed to change, the kind of change that ensures nothing like this ever happens again and guarantees the values of safety and equity are at the forefront of all of our work, the kind of love and mindfulness that Justine's life championed. It was important for the Ruschick family that the city continue to make change, systemic change, and we are committed to making that change a reality for everyone in our city.
Thank you, and we have a few minutes for questions.
Mayor, this is the largest police-related settlement in Minnesota by about 5 times. The settlement reached in record time. I don't think it's lost on anyone that the officer happened to be black and the victim happened to be white. Do all these things spell out institutional racism in the criminal and civil justice system here in Minneapolis?
Police departments across the United States are dealing with matters of institutionalized racism, and I don't think our department in Minneapolis is any different. What I can say is that we are exceedingly committed to making change. Our chief is committed to a culture shift, and there are numerous policies that are underway. I will say that every claim and every case brings forward a different set of circumstances, and the circumstances before us with this particular case were also unique.
So is this the worst one that we've ever had? Is that why the settlement is so high? I mean, you guys met on Jamar Clark this morning also. That was, what, 5 years ago? Why isn't there a settlement on that?
I can't speak to the whether it was the worst one or not. I can only speak to the matters before us here. As I mentioned, every claim, every matter that is brought forth to litigation is different. I think there are two facts that stand out. One of them is the unprecedented criminal conviction of third-degree murder. And the other was that as the proceedings were making clear, Officer Knorr identified no threat before using force.
Mayor, perhaps for you or maybe the chief, I know the family, at least in the past, has spoken about not just the money in this case, but making a change. They talked about training. They talked about, you know, potential cover-up by those wearing the uniform. Does the settlement at all address any of those concerns?
I think that would more be a question for the family as to what the settlement does or does not address. But you accurately stated that there are many reforms that are already underway, and I'm sure that the chief could further speak to him if you'd like.
Thank you, Mayor. As the mayor has stated, and certainly as you have asked in the questions, when I took over as chief, it was very important for me to recognize the culture of the Minneapolis Police Department and the strengths that we've had, but certainly some of the areas where we have fallen short and where that has impacted communities. And we have, and I certainly have been very intentional about addressing those shifts. Probably the most important, which is outlined first and foremost in my vision for the department moving forward, is sanctity of life. And out of all of the interactions that we have with our community members, we realize that there are inherent dangers, but the overwhelming majority of those contacts does not require force. So sanctity of life is very important. Our de-escalation, our crisis intervention training is so key for our officers, and all of that under a procedural justice lens, ensuring that we're giving our community both voice, respect, building spaces of trust, and having some neutral engagements. Council Member Pomisano, when this very tragic incident occurred, our body-worn camera policy was not where it should have been. And quite frankly, that hurt us in many aspects. With trust, through her staunch efforts, through a robust auditing system now, we are seeing that upwards near 90%+. That is very key, very helpful. But it's all going to boil down to our relationships. Each and every day, our men and women have to be out there building those relationships of trust, and I'm certainly committed to making sure that we continue to do that to move this department forward.
And Chief, with you at the podium, I just think back. Yeah. I was in that news conference with Don Damon, and really the searing response about, you know, that motto on the squad doors, something to the effect of compassion and courage. And where was it that night? Yeah. Would you answer Don Damon in that?
Yeah, so I've actually had private conversations with Mr. Damon as recently as the last couple of days. So we've had those discussions. What I will tell you is, unfortunately, that did not occur that night with Mr. Knorr. And so, but that is not reflective of the majority of the men and women on this department. As Mayor Fry said, this was an unprecedented case where we've had former employee charged with third-degree murder. That's never happened before. And so I'm focused on making sure that we can move forward and begin to work with our elected officials and our community to heal. So,
and,
yes.
And we got another question, just because we haven't had you in front of us since the trial. I know you're bound by internal reviews of this case, but then there definitely was some, you know, concern about the way some of your officers testified across the street. Do you want to address that publicly for us? Do you have concerns, be it Sergeant Barnett, be it anything else that we heard at that trial, who cooperated, who didn't?
Well, I can't go into specifics of that. We, as very standard, we will do a full internal review of the Justine Damon Ruschick case. We will do an internal review of that, and all parties to that, within all of our employees, we will be looking at policies, procedures, training, and so that is still an ongoing matter for us.
Chief, yeah. Was there anything that you heard as far as testimony from officers or any of that body camera footage from the scene that troubled you, that concerned you?
That would all be a part of that internal review that we will conduct.
We've got time for probably one more question.
Can anyone talk about Bob Bennett had filed a letter earlier this year that said the city had planned to not indemnify the officer? It seems to me you have a third-degree murder conviction. That shows he acted so outside your training. That would be an even greater argument to not indemnify him. Did this come up at all, or why did the city choose to indemnify him?
So Our city attorney probably can answer any portion of that question can be answered. However, my assumption is that it cannot be because we are not allowed to disclose any conversations that are either attorney-client privilege or happen during the course of the mediation. But Susan, if you're able to, you can. Or you can reiterate what I just said.
Right. Yeah, I can't discuss exactly in this case what happened. Generally, there is a state law obligation to indemnify, but in this case, we're under federal law. And so that was and continues to be a consideration. As you know, in at least one past recent case, the city did deny defense and indemnity, and the Minnesota Court of Appeals upheld that. But as in any legal case, we have to weigh risks and what a federal judge might rule against whatever legal precedent we have.
Okay. And not to belabor this, but I think that all our readers and listeners and viewers are going to ask if the racial dynamic played a role in this case being treated differently, you know, including the timing, including the amount. Can you just, what do you say to them, to the people who were out there protesting the other day saying that this case is being treated differently because of race? How, you know, can you convince them that that's not the case? Or is it the case?
I would tell them that I understand their frustration. There's a long history in our country and sadly in our city, of justice not entirely being done and sometimes being denied. As to the discrepancy, I gave you several reasons as to why there was a discrepancy. I noted this is the first time that an individual has been convicted of third-degree murder. Additionally, this is, as the proceedings made clear, there was not a clear threat before the use of force was made, as per Mr. North's statements. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you.